some 54th session of the series. We are very fortunate today to have Sohail Hashmi come in to give us a talk. And he is, of course, as you know, I mean, I was telling him that, you know, he doesn't really need introduction, but as I think it is customary to say a few words about the speaker. And he is a filmmaker, a historian. He conducts these walks in Delhi, which are extremely popular. I think more than that, you know, I think he's a very good storyteller. I remember him like that, actually. And so therefore, it's very nice that he could come and tell us some stories about, what is it? The Song of Stones, of course. And I'll just say a few words about there are many people here who've been here before and who know what this event is generally about. But it was started as an attempt to get architects to relate more closely to society, the people they serve. Because as you know, that in the last 100 years certainly, architects have become more and more abstract and are rather out of touch. So people build and architects draw. There seems to be very little relationship between the two. So we started this series of talks some time ago, and we somehow managed to continue it, because it's not always easy to find a speaker who will be, who will hold people's attention on matters which are not specialized. And we are trying to actually bring back architecture into general, as a general life, general science, rather than a very specialized thing. So with this little introduction, let me request Sohail Bhai to start his talk, and I'll go and join the audience.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to present some stray thoughts that have come to me while I have been conducting these walks over the last 15 years, and some connections that I have made in what's been going on in architecture, primarily in Delhi and around, from the 12th century onwards. And I'm starting with this image. This is not an upside down image. This is actually the reflection of the Taj in the horse, which is on the viewing platform. And Shah Jahan's intention was that the visitors to the monument see the entire structure and its reflection simultaneously. And that's why when you entered from the south gate, originally, what you could see was only the top of the dome, because there were trees up to your eye line. These trees were cut down on the orders of the archaeologist in charge of restoring the Taj. He called his horticulturist and he said, cut down the trees, you can't see the pretty thing. And then they planted grass. So this entire thing of grassy lawns and all that is a gift of the English. This is not our idea of the garden. Our idea of the garden was to have trees that gave you shade, trees that gave you fruit. And we made small flower beds. And if we were near a source of water, we had streams or water channels. That is how we made our gardens. Wherever the English went, they wanted the imitation of the Scottish dales. And this all these grassy lawns is a product of that. Actually, planting grass, especially in these parts, is not a very clever idea. 9 months a year, you can't sit on it. It's too awfully hot. And the other 3 months, it is soaking wet in dew. In any case, if you begin walking on it, it dies. So wherever you see these beautiful grassy lawns, you have these signboards. Do not walk on the grass. It is only good to look at. And the quantity of water that is required to keep it green, you can actually grow a forest in that kind of water. But they were the rulers. And what they did was right. So everybody begins to imitate them. But this was only one of the things. They also inverted our own understanding of our heritage. And what I'm going to be talking about is about that. And that is why I begin with this image, which looks like an inversion. I call this song sung by stones. 8 centuries of adaption, accommodation, absorption and appropriation. And that is some of the things that we'll be looking at through rather simple things. Now, it's been said that God is in the details. I don't believe in God. I think the devil is also in the details. And that is where I'm going. Now, this I don't have to explain. There might be among the younger generation, there might be some people who have not drunk water from a pitcher. But any one of us who has even a few speckles of grey knows what a ghada is or a matka is.
Surahi
and a whole lot of things. Now, the pitcher actually, each ancient civilization was known by the pottery they made. The Roman amphoras, the Grecian urns, the terracottas from the Indus Valley civilization, the PGW or the painted grayware from later times. Where it began is disputed. Some people are insisting that it was brought to India by the Aryans, you know. But each civilization that grew in anywhere, you know, including the Incas and Mayas, each one of them was known by the pottery they made. Pottery making begins when wandering in search of food stops. You settle down to agriculture, and that is when pottery happens. The wheel has already been invented. Probably a broken wheel from a cart becomes the potter's wheel, and gradually the skill develops. You also learn to fire the vessels you are making, and then you discover that you can store water in it. And this is a major revolutionary step. Because this frees you from the tyranny of the river. Till you learn how to make pottery, you had to go in search of water every time you felt thirsty. Now you had water in your hut or wherever you were spending the night. You felt thirsty, you poured water out of a vessel that you had fashioned. But somebody had to go and fetch water. Who would do that? I don't know about the rest of the world. In India, it was women. Men normally don't do anything, they make other people work, especially women. So even today, women in our villages continue to cross long distances. Even in Delhi, where there's shortage of water and you get water from a tanker, is the women who have to go and fetch the water. And they've been doing it for centuries, if not longer. Now, they pitcher is made when we are started growing crops and taking harvests. One immediate problem was, where do you keep your harvest? So we started making large earthenware pots. They were known as storage, they have been known as storage bins and storage urns or whatever. And we have found quite a lot of them in the late Harappan period, in Rakhi Gadi, in Farmana, in Haryana and all that. And we also made small vessels in which we stored seed for the next crop. And this is where the fun begins. Because these small vessels contained seed, therefore life. So they began to be seen as the womb of the mother. And we began to call them Garbh Kalash. And they began to be used in fertility rituals. And fertility rituals were for a bumper crop, more cattle, and large families. And this continues. Every marriage that takes place, you have a large kalash and a smaller kalash lined with mango leaves, topped with a coconut. This is a fertility symbol. And it continues to be used in the modern fertility rituals we know them as marriages. So, the kalash, because of this significance that is given to it, begins to be carved in temples when we start making temples. Most of our original temples were to gods of fertility. All ancient civilizations had at least two gods, a god of birth and a god of death. These were things that we didn't understand. Whatever you didn't understand became a god. So you had temples to gods of fertility, to gods of birth, and to gods of death. And the kalash was associated with both, especially in civilizations where cremations took place. And even among those civilizations where burials took place, and Harappa was one of them, they buried people in large earthenware pots. They placed them inside the pot and the pot was buried. So the pot has connections to life and birth, life and death. And we also use vessels for cooking. And this is Fanule. From almost 5,000 years from today. And this is another set. Cooking vessels, storage jars, burial urns, and burial pottery. And burial pottery happens with a whole lot of civilization that believed in rebirth. The idea was that the person who's been buried, he's going to come back to life and he's going to need everything that he used in his life. So small replicas of everything were buried with them. And pottery continues to be used in all kinds of ways, like in this 2004 photograph from Bhuj. These four piles, they will contain rice or lentils or rough grains that they eat. They will also contain all the wealth of the family. And the lady of the house will know where she has hidden the money and where she has hidden the jewelry inside, buried deep inside a kalash full of rice or grain or millet or whatever. This also contained your clothes. This was your wardrobe as well. And now the practice is no longer very common, but till the time that I was in school, and if you reached school in a shirt or trouser that was crumpled and it hadn't been ironed properly, one or the other teacher would ask you, "Ghade mein se nikal ke pehna hai kya? Have you pulled it out of a pitcher?" And that is how it worked, because there was no furniture. You can see that corner in that photograph. There is a string on which clothes are hung. That is how most people used to store their clothes, either there or folded inside the pitcher. The pitcher, as I was telling you, becomes a part of temple architecture. This is a pillar from the first mosque built in Delhi by Qutbuddin Aibak, wrongly or deliberately called Masjid-e-Qubbatul Islam. Qutbuddin Aibak never called it that. He called it Jami Masjid. The title Qubbatul Islam is a contribution of English art historians, because they want to connect mosque building with force, etc., etc. That's why the name. But why I have this image is because of the kalash. There's a kalash in the middle. And it is this kalash that led archaeologists to reach the conclusion that these were Jain temples. Jain temples have four things that are common to their carving: kalash, nagas, snakes with human faces or human body and ending into a long snake which was coiled, demonic faces, and ropes and bells. These are four features of all Jain temples, and almost all the pillars have one or two of these features. But the kalash is what we are concerned with. Above the kalash you see a serrated edge, wheel kind of a thing. That is a kalash. That is an amalaka. But we'll come to the amalaka a little later. This is the kalash that I have described to you earlier. You see those sharp things projecting from the mouths of the kalash? That is the mango leaves. And I don't know whether you can see clearly, the base of the kalash and the top of the neck has some carvings on it. These are lotus petals, and that is another thing that we will talk about today. But you see where the kalash is placed? You see the right hand corner? There is Arabic calligraphy there, and it says Bismillah, begin in the name of God. Now, this is the base of the three arches that Qutbuddin Aibak built in the mosque. Everything else was taken from temples. The only thing they constructed were these three arches, and they were covered with Arabic calligraphy. Why the kalash there? The kalash and Bismillah. Islam has just arrived in India, at least in North India. And you are building the first mosque in Delhi. And you have the kalash and you have Bismillah. And this is something that we are going to be, this theme is something that we'll be returning to again and again. But let's continue with the kalash for the time being. The top left corner, that is the Alai Darwaza, the top two. And you can see the motif of the kalash repeated again and again. The bottom left is Adham Khan's mausoleum, and the one next at the bottom is from the Khazanchi's Haveli in Chandni Chowk. 13th century, 16th century and 19th century. And the kalash continues. The first three were commissioned by Muslims, the fourth by a Hindu. We'll come back to the kalash a little later. Now let's talk about the lotus. Now, I have this theory. I could be totally wrong. I could just be flying a kite, but that is my theory. which is that before any religion is born, there was animism. And all ancient societies, all tribal communities were animists. They believed everything was animated. There was the spirit of the forest, the spirit of the river, the spirit of the rock, the spirit of the tree. And that's why tribal communities, when they took from nature, they took only as much as they needed and not more. And they made a ritual. A little digression, let me tell you. Friend of mine had just traveled to Mongolia and he spent some time with the people who continue to practice transhumance, following the herds of their animals. So he was traveling with them. And after a few days, the head of the family decided to prepare a feast for these guests who had come from India. So he went to the pen where they had kept all their lambs, and he brought a lamb, squatted on the ground, drew the lamb to his breast, and slowly talked to him for 10-15 minutes before killing it. And then it was cooked and served to his guests. So this friend of mine has made a short video of this. And he asked him, what were you talking to the lamb about? What were you saying to it? So he said, I was apologizing to the lamb and seeking his permission to kill him. And I told him that I have these guests who have come from a long distance and I have to, because this is my duty as a host, to give them the best that I can, and that is why I have to kill you. Now, this is how animist societies, tribal societies, related to nature. It is in this time that I think that somebody walking through an open space comes across a pool of stagnant water, filled with mud, decaying vegetation, earthworms, snails, frogs, general stink. This is what happens in stagnant pools, and this beautiful lotus. And I believe the person who first noticed this was a woman. Because I think that women notice these things much before men do. And she saw this lotus and said to herself that you can rise above all this and be pure. Now, centuries, perhaps thousands of years later, we imagined gods, anthropomorphic gods. Gods that they were gods in human form. And all ancient societies imagined such gods. And no matter which civilization imagined anthropomorphic gods, there is one thing common among all of them. Actually, several things common among all of them. Not one of them has more than two legs. All of them are bipeds. All. Whether imagined by the Mayans or the Incas or the Egyptians or Indians, all of them have two legs. All of them have families. All of them have children. All of them feel hungry. They have to be fed. They get angry and you have to placate them like you have to placate your parents or your children. And you organize all kinds of rituals to make them happy. So in all these details, they are like us, but they are not like us, because they can fly, they can multitask, they can understand the language of the animals, so they have animal heads, they have multiple hands, etc., etc. But since they are like us in so many ways, they would need to sit down once in a while. Where would they sit? They could not sit on the ground like ordinary mortals, because they are gods. They can only sit in some place which is pure. And that is how you have all the gods in the lotus. Brahma, Mahesh, Vishnu. Now, here he is not sitting in the lotus. Here the lotus is coming out of his navel, from which is born Brahma. Now, this is an interesting digression, Because we are told Brahma created the universe. But Brahma is born out of a lotus which grows out of the navel of Vishnu, who rests on the coils of the Sheshnag, who swims in the Sheer Sagar. So the Sheer Sagar, the Sheshnag, Vishnu and the lotus, all of them pre-exist Srishti. This is one question that I don't think we have addressed adequately, but there it is. Then you have Lakshmi inside the lotus, you have Saraswati inside the lotus, you have Kartike, who is hardly ever worshipped in the north, but is the biggest god in the south, the son of Shiva, and Ganesh, the son of Parvati, who is worshipped across in the north and the south, and the god of good omen. And then you had historical figures who are deified, Mahavir and Gautam, and they are both placed in the lotus. All the other gods are mythological. These two are historical figures. We know exactly when they were born, who their parents were, etc., etc. Both of them are placed in the lotus. Buddhism travels and reaches Tibet. And the Tibetan Buddhists invent or imagine the feminine Buddha, Tara, and she is placed in the lotus. Buddha is always invariably accompanied with two people, two bodhisattvas, Vajrapani and Padmapani. Padmapani later is exalted to become Avalokiteshvara, and there you see, this is how he is depicted in the Far East, and you can see these multiple arms. I've seen an image of Buddha with a 100 in the, what is this valley? In Himachal, Spiti. And this is Bodhisattva, Padmapani. You can see the lotus in his hand. And now we return to the arch built by Qutubuddin Aibak in his mosque again. The word that that you can see, if any one of you can read Arabic, but otherwise I'll tell you, it says Al-Masjid, the mosque. This is where the description begins. Now this text would originally have been drawn on the drawings of the arches that the architect made. And then the calligrapher would have written the text that will go on each arch. Now this would have been small drawings. But when this is expanded into an arch which is 40, 50, 60 feet, I don't know how long, how tall, the words would have become larger and the open spaces would have become would have expanded, and then they would have seen when they started writing them on the stone to be carved that there is so much empty space. So the mason is asked to embellish the text. The mason is Indian. He knows this is the holy text of these new people, and he knows this text needs special treatment. What does he embellish it with? With the purest of all flowers, with the lotus. And nobody had any problem. Nobody had any problem. The architect would have asked him, what flower is this? He said, this is a holy flower. That's it, end of discussion. Next to that is the image from a close-up of the Alai Darwaza. Can you see the lotus buds? Half lotuses, full lotuses. Yes. The Alai Darwaza is totally covered in lotuses, totally. And in the middle, there are panels of verses from the Quran. Nobody said, this is heathen, this is non-believer, we can't have this. No. We required an art historian from England to come and tell us that. That is the entry to the mausoleum of Firoz Tughlaq. The two sides of the arch, the spandrels, looked empty. So the mason, this one is a close-up, the mason put the lotus there. This is the central arch of the Jamali Kamali Mosque. And look at the detail. There is not only a lotus. The lotus is surrounded by white marble triangles. And they represent the sun. And the Muslims venerated neither the lotus nor the sun. This is the main arch of the mosque. The dome arrives. The first dome in Delhi was attempted to build in 1287 on the mausoleum of Ghiyasuddin Balban. This is also where the first true arch was used. The dome collapsed, the mausoleum with its four true arches stands. When the dome arrived, our mason, the Indian mason, looked at this hemisphere and he wasn't very happy. This, to his eye, this looked like a work in progress. It suddenly ended, there was nothing on top. It looked unfinished. The dome in the Central Asian tradition represented the heavens, and the top of the dome represented the seventh heaven. And who lives on the seventh heaven? God Almighty. He lives there. So the dome is covered with lotus petals because that is the throne of God. You see what is happening? The dome represents the heavens, the top of the dome represents where God lives, and you cover it with a lotus. In the next stage, the lotus shrinks and it covers just the top, which is where God sits. If this was heaven, the one below, the top is broken. I have a suspicion that this had a kalash on it. And I have good reason to believe that. I'll show you an image like that. But from there, we jump to the 17th century. These are three images from the Red Fort. From the Rang Mahal, from the Sheesh Mahal, and the Lotus Fountain in the Rang Mahal. And next to that, that is the main entry to the mosque built by Aurangzeb Alamgir in Lahore, known as the Badshahi Masjid. Those two little minarets, three actually, one at that corner and two, not the large minaret, but the small minarets. If you look at them closely, there are small cupolas, small domes, placed inside lotuses. And even Aurangzeb had no problem with the lotus. Now we come to the Amalaka. This is normally placed above the shikhar and below the kalash is seen either as the lotus, the seat of the deity, or as the sun. This is Khajuraho. This is the votive temple from Ashapuri, and the text below has switched. The image on this side is the Mageshwar temple from Bhuvaneshwar, 12th century, and the white dome is the mausoleum of Zafar Khan from the 14th century. The right on top of the dome is the Amalaka, and above that you can see a broken kalash. Now what is happening? The masons begin to experiment with the top of the dome. And this experiment continues for 300 years. And they are constantly trying to work various things to place, from the lotus covering the entire dome to a shrunk lotus, then the kalash, then the lotus and the kalash, or the amalaka and the kalash. And these experimentations continue. And then all this begins to come together. So that top image, this is the lotus and the amalaka. This is the mosque built by the wet nurse of Akbar, Mahamanga. This is located opposite the zoo. The Nila Gumbad, This is a Timurid dome. There are just two Timurid domes in Delhi. This is one of them. And the shape of the dome is very, very Central Asian. But if you look at the finial, it has the lotus, the Amalaka, the lotus upright, the lotus turned upside down, then upright, and then upside down. That is what is there in the finial. Similarly, in the mausoleum of Isa Khan, completed in 1547, outside the mausoleum of Humayun, and the next one is a close-up. And you can see the same array again. The lotus, the Amalaka, and then two upside-down lotuses and two upright lotuses. And the same thing continues in these structures as well, built in different times. This I have talked about already, but we'll see what happens to it. This is the Sun Temple in Chandni Chowk, Gauri Shankar Mandir in Chandni Chowk, Gurdwara Sis Ganj in Chandni Chowk, and Dera Sahib, Lahore, outside the fort built by Akbar. And you can see that minaret. That is the minaret of the Badshahi Mosque. So they are just next to each other. This is on the mausoleum of Adham Khan. Then Digambar Jain Lal Mandir and Fatehpur Sikri Mosque. Now this, from the earlier play of lotus and Amalaka and all that, in these two slides, I am showing you the modified version of two kalashes and a coconut. Incidentally, the coconut represents the womb as well. And that is why in North Indian weddings, at least, once the girl goes to her in-law's house, there is a ritual called Godbharai. She sits cross-legged on the floor and all kinds of presents are piled in her lap, and the coconut is a must. The coconut, incidentally, in the south, represents the human head, and that is why you smash it, which is a continuation of the idea of human sacrifice. Now this is the Fatehpuri Mosque, same two kalashes and a cone. This is on the mausoleum of Nizamuddin, but this is not as old as the mausoleum itself. This originally, the mausoleum of Nizamuddin was open to the skies. This was added in the time of either Shah Alam or Muhammad Shah. This is where two kalashes and a finial design was first used in the mausoleum of Humayun. I have shown you Isa Khan mausoleum, built in 1547, 22 years before Humayun's tomb, and that has the complex kalash, amalaka, kalash, you know, lotus, lotus, amalaka, lotus. That is 1547, this is 1569. This is where it is first used. This is a close-up, that is the older one. This is the new one, because the old one fell off in a massive storm we had, and this new one was built. When the interpretation center at Humayun's tomb opens next year, you will be able to see the original one. Just to give you an idea of the size of the dome, that finial is 22 feet. At the Taj, the finial is 29 feet. This is the same design at the Jama Masjid, at the Moti Masjid built by Aurangzeb, at the Fakhrul Masajid built by Fakhrul Nisa Begum, near Kashmiri Gate. And now the swastika. Now you can see in that little box, Hopi, Christian, Malta, Tibet, Ceylon, India, Japan, Islamic, Aztec, Jain, Greek, Jewish, Lapland, and Hindu, Celtic, and from Bali. We don't stop insisting that it is our creation. That is Fatehpur Sikri. That is the mausoleum of Quli Khan, the foster brother of Akbar and younger brother of Adham Khan. This mausoleum is in the Malolli Archaeological Park. This is the mausoleum of Atgha Khan, built by Akbar. He was the chief bodyguard of Akbar, killed by Adham Khan in that famous altercation in the Agra fort. This large arch that I've shown you there, this has 8 swastikas in it. And there are 8 of these arches, 2 on each side. So 64 swastikas surrounding the mausoleum. This is the mausoleum of Akbar. And look at the third image. You see the swastika there? This is the central panel in this gate. And there are 4 of them outside and 4 inside. No, 6 outside and 6 inside the main gate. That gate that is there in the first image. This is in the Lahore fort. Shah Jahan built a special gate only for the use of the royalty. And bordering the gate on both sides, the wall, running into several hundred meters are these glazed tiles, which would have been specially commissioned, because glazing tiles, you made tiles, then you fired them in this shape, and then they were fixed here. Now, this is what it is. This is where it all began. And that is why every ancient civilization has the swastika in some form or the other. When we moved out of Africa 70,000 years ago and began our journey moving in all directions, 60,000 years ago there were people living in central India. 60,000 years ago they had reached New Zealand and Australia, and they reached the Americas 30,000 years ago. This 10,000 year old journey was done hugging the coast and hopping islands. The level of the oceans was much lower, and the oceans were dotted with large number of islands. As long as they were moving in forested territory, you know, you moved during the day, you oriented yourself with sun, and but at night when you were in the ocean or you were in the desert, how did you orient yourself? And this only happened in the northern hemisphere. They saw this one star and this constellation that went around it. It was here at sunset, it was here at midnight, it was here at sunrise, and then it disappeared and it appeared again. And it seemed to rotate around that fixed point. And that became our guiding source. And that is how you have the swastika in every culture. Every ancient culture has some form or the other of the swastika. This, we have been told, is the Star of David. Now, I'll not go into the story of the Star of David. There are questions later. But in the Indian tradition, this is known as the Adi Yantra or the Shakti Chakra. This triangle represents masculine energy, Shiva, and this triangle represents feminine energy, Shakti. And this symbol began to be used extensively with the rise of the Tantric cult. And if you are out on the streets in Delhi, every third Maruti van has this six-cornered star painted on the rear glass with Ma written on it. The six-cornered star is also used by devil worshippers. You have to write 666 inside. It is used for planchet calling. Any one of you who, and when the time when I was in college, it was a very fashionable exercise, especially with the four Gujarati girls who were in my class. They used to keep on calling the dead aunts of one or the other every Tuesday in their hostel, and middle of the night they'll run out shrieking. I don't know what thrills it gave them, but you know, this was an interesting pastime. The earliest we see the six-cornered star is in the Alai Darwaza. On two sides, and there are those that close up on top. The six-cornered star is placed inside a circle, which in the Indian tradition would mean universe in harmony. The male energy and female energy are in perfect balance, and the circle represents harmony. The six-cornered triangle, the hexagram there on the spandrel of the arch is from Adham Khan's mausoleum. There is a lotus inside. And the same thing, built roughly the same time. Adham Khan's mausoleum and Humayun's mausoleum were roughly built in the same time. Adham Khan's mausoleum was, I think, built a little later. And this is the entry to the mausoleum, and you can see the six-cornered star and the lotus inside. And here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12, 13, 14 six-cornered stars on each face. And there are four faces, of which two have the lotus inside, the one on the central arch. This is the shape of the arch, but this is not an arch, because the arch is made with wedge-shaped stones, with a keystone in the middle, held together with plaster. This is carved out of a single piece of rock. This is from Ajanta. But the shape of the arch is there. And if you look at this, you will know what this shape is. This is an inverted boat. And if you go into any of the parihars in Ajanta, you will see the entire roof is designed like a boat, with all the planks and jointing plank carved in wood. From which I think that the idea for a vaulted roof came to somebody who was an architect and had to spend a night under an inverted boat, a stormy night, and that is where he probably looked at that and said, you can probably create a structure without pillars. And it was first carved in stone, through sheer rock. But to make it actually happen took a very long time, very, very long time. Before that, we had the treviet. Beams with lintels on. This is how we started building when we were building with wood. But when we shifted to stone, we continued using the same method. The problem was wood, because of its elasticity, could take a weight. And wood wasn't so heavy. So you could build two-story, three-storied structures with wood. The moment you shifted to stone and started making two-storied structures, the top, the weight of the superstructure would come on the beams and the beams would crack. And therefore, a solution had to be found. This is another treviet, and this is the solution. You had posts. Then you had stones projecting gradually inwards, and then you place the beam on top, so the top beam received support from beneath. That is how we used to make grand arches. If you wanted to make an arch that was good enough for an elephant to enter, can you imagine how tall the arch will have to be? An elephant is about 9 feet. You put a king on top of the elephant, 14 feet. The king decides to wave to his subjects. Maybe he's carrying a spear in his hand or a flag. You need 16, 17 feet of clearance. Your pillars, posts, will have to be about 20 feet high, and then the central beam, which had to be one single piece, will have to be lifted to that height. We did not have pulleys. So you will probably need to build a ramp or work something to, or you know, hundreds of people will pull it, tie it to ropes and pull it to that side. But that is where we were stuck till the true arch arrived. But when the true arch arrived, our mason did not trust constructions with small bits of stone, because we thought strength comes from large pieces of stone. The architect is constantly giving them the shape of the arch, and the Indian mason is convinced that this building is going to fall. And as happens these days, the architects design, collect their fees and go, and then the builder has to build it. If something goes wrong, the builder says, "I told you so." And these people don't know anything. So the mason is trying to buy himself insurance. And you see what all he does. This is the main arch for entry into the mosque built by Qutbuddin Aibak. You see that black stone on top? That is a single piece. And then there are stones that are buried inside the wall. This is not a true arch. This is a corbel arch masquerading as a true arch. The mason probably tells the architect, "You want this shape, I'll give it to you. But don't tell me how to make it, I know." While making it like this, he is still not sure that this will hold. So he fills up the entire arch with stone and places a beam inside and a corbel. And this again went on for 300 years. The arch actually comes into its own towards the end of Jahangir's time and the beginning of Shah Jahan's time. For this 300 years, every time, or mostly, a load-bearing arch is to be made, the mason quietly inserts the corbel inside. This is another false arch. This is the mausoleum of Shamsuddin al-Tamash. This is also one of the sites where a dome was built and fell, and it was built again and it fell, and then they gave up. This is Nasiruddin Mahmud's mausoleum in Vasant Kunj. This is the second monumental mausoleum built in India, because he died before Shamsuddin al-Tamash. He was the governor of Bengal, died of food poisoning. This is what I mean. You see that? There is no keystone. That slab has been cut in the shape to give you the shape of the arch, and you have all these corbels. And this continues. This is Fatehpur Sikri, our first time. So from the time of Nasiruddin Mahmud, from the time of the Tughlaqs, and even the end of the slave dynasty, to Akbar, the corbel continues. And then they learn. And this is how they coexisted. There's an arch which has been filled, and in that the corbel has been inserted. If you look at the second stone from below, can you see a familiar shape?
I'll point to it.
That is the head of the elephant. Had this been a temple, these two would have been Gajalakshmis. But this is not a temple, this is a mausoleum. And Islam prohibits the depiction of animal forms. there would have been a very interesting exchange between the architect and the builder and the mason. Because the mason has been carving the head of the elephant here for centuries. His father told him, who learned from his great father, and you know, it goes on. And that is how skills are transmitted. But now he is not building a temple, he is building somebody's mausoleum. And the mason is told, sorry, no elephant. And he cannot put a block of stone there. And he doesn't know what else to put there because this order is fixed. So there is a little adjustment. He removes the tusks, the ears, and the eye. But he retains the curve of the trunk. And other interesting things are happening. This is a true arch. Mausoleum of the palace of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. The mason is convinced this is going to fall. He inserts a beam inside and converts a true arch into a treviated arch. You see the elephant's head? It's far more clear here. And on the cheek, can you see a chessboard kind of design? You know what that is? That is the eternal Chinese knot, which you will see in all Chinese restaurants, on their menu, on their lanterns. This design traveled through the Silk Route to Central Asia, and with the Central Asians it came to India, and our masons took a liking to it, and they began carving it. It is all over medieval buildings. True arch, corbel inserted inside. True arch, corbel inserted inside. This is Kabiruddin Aulia, he was a disciple of Nizamuddin. This is Isa Khan's mausoleum. You can see the true arch behind and the corbel in front. And this is the earliest true arch that I have seen, built in the 4th or 3rd century. This is in the foundation of the hippodrome of built by Constantine in the city, the second Rome that he had built, which came to be known as Constantinople. He built a horse racing track. This is in the foundation. So the Turks have known of the true art at least from the 4th century. And it arrived in India in the end of the 13th century. Almost 900 years the true art has taken to travel from Turkey to India. And this is the magic. And you will appreciate it in the next image. You see that? There is no plaster left. The keystone is in place. And that's why the arch is there. Leonardo da Vinci defined an arch as strength created by two weaknesses. The keystone provides that phenomenal strength. You can't see this. I saw this in 1967. I didn't have a camera. I eventually was able to get a camera fairly recently in the mid-90s. That is when I went and took this photograph. And the ASI has repaired it beyond recognition. So now you won't see this magic. When the Turks arrived in India, we used to build, as I have already told you, with massive blocks of stone. And the Turks brought in the technology of building with rubble. Rubble held together with a plaster, which was a mixture of crushed bricks and limestone. This building, and a large number of buildings built in Delhi, from the 13th century, well into the 16th century, and this is 16th century, were built with combining both techniques. The pillars are all built using the technique that pre-existed, and the superstructure, the arches, the domes are all built using the new technique that arrived with the Turks. So when two civilizations meet, they are not constantly killing each other, they also create. And when they create properly, this is what happens. Shortly, four or five images, all of you would have seen or read or heard of the term called Islamic architecture. This is one of the earliest mosques built in India. Islam actually first reached Gujarat and Kerala through Arab traders, because Arabs had been trading with India much before the birth of Islam. And it is through the Arab trader that Islam arrived first in Gujarat and then in. And this is the first mosque built. This mosque was built in the time when Prophet Muhammad was still alive. A local king called Chiraman heard of this new religion. He traveled to Mecca, met the Prophet, converted to Islam, was traveling back when he died on his return journey. And he asked those who had gone with him to build this mosque for him. This was the shape it was in 1958. It has now been modified, and false domes and all that have been added. I've recently heard that the administration, the committee that administers this, have decided to remove all the additions and go back to the original look. This is the earliest mosque in Kashmir. Shahi Hamdan, who is believed to have introduced Islam to Kashmir in the 8th century, 8th or 9th century. This is a mosque built by Nur Jahan. It's known as the Pathar Masjid. It is in downtown Srinagar. This is the Jama Masjid of Srinagar. This is a 300-year-old mosque in Thailand. This is the Demak Mosque in Indonesia, 17th century mosque in Belgium. Did you see any minarets? Did you see any domes? Did you see any arches? This whole thing of Hindu architecture and Islamic architecture is a whole lot of nonsense. I'm sure none of you has ever come across the term Christian architecture. It doesn't exist. Their architecture is Baroque, Renaissance, Gothic, Classical, Neoclassical, or it is Prussian, Slavic, Portuguese, Spanish. Our architecture is not Hoysala, is not Vijayanagar, it is not Chera, it is not Chola, it is not Bengal architecture, it is not Jaisalmer architecture, it's not Jodhpur architecture. It is not Kashmir architecture. It is only Hindu architecture. And all the architecture from Turkey to Afghanistan is only Muslim. Because they wanted to put us into small little watertight compartments and colonize our minds. And they left these categories for us. And we continue to talk only in these terms. If there was something called Islamic architecture, then at least all the mosques should look the same. I've shown you the mosque. The dome reached Arabia much later. Much, much later. There is this famous mosque in Istanbul known as the Blue Mosque, and opposite that is Hagia Sophia. The Hagia Sophia was originally a Greek Orthodox church. The Greek Orthodox were defeated by the Roman Catholics, so it became a Roman Catholic church. The Roman Catholics were defeated by Byzantine Muslims, and it became a mosque. And then Kemal Ataturk converted that mosque into a museum. Same building. The building has not changed its religion, because buildings do not have religion. If you go to Kashmir, you will not find a single old mosque that has a dome. There is one mosque that is most photographed and is there on every publication on Kashmir, known as the Hazrat Bal Mosque. That mosque was built by my chacha, who was an architect who went from Delhi. It's not a very bright idea to build domes in areas with heavy snowfall. Dome as an architectural form evolved in a climate which does not have heavy snowfall and heavy rain. Domes are built on flat roofs. That's why in Indonesia, in Malaysia, in none of those places which have heavy rainfall do you have domed roofs. The largest dome in the world is the St. Peter's Basilica. And there is a huge dome in Washington, D.C. And I can promise you, Muslims had nothing to do with it. Thank you.
Thank you for the engrossing talk. And I'm really here so that I can moderate questions and generally begin the discussion. There will be a mic which will be passed around when you ask questions, I hope. And please identify yourself before you ask the question, because the mic helps us to record the whole thing, the whole discussion. So the floor is open. There's no need of any further protocol. Questions are welcome, I'm sure. So you'll be happy to elaborate on things.
That was a very interesting point you made about
identify yourself.
Nilanjan. I'm a regular at your talks.
Yes, yes.
Everyone. That was a very interesting point you made, Professor Hashmi, about the Afghans and Turks trying to categorize us into little boxes, which we have continued with over the
centuries. Not Afghans and Turks.
Oh,
the white, our masters.
Our European masters.
Yes.
I see. So could you please expand on this? What exactly did you mean by this? And that we've continued it over the centuries.
Yeah. You see, essentially what I'm saying is that European architecture has never been looked at in denominational terms. Never. European architecture is presented either as response of a culture, the Slavs, the Hispanics, the Portuguese, the Prussians, or it is part of a large cultural movement, an era like Renaissance, like Baroque, you know, which the impact of that was felt over a large territory in Europe. That is how they have always seen their architecture. But they refuse to recognize these diversities in the subcontinent or in what came to be known as the exotic East. We were only seen through denominational terms, that this is Muslims, this is the kind of architecture they'll build. I'll give you an example that might illustrate this better. Tombs have been written on the Mughal garden. Tombs.
Yeah.
And each one of them begins by saying that the inspiration for the Mughal garden comes from the description of heaven in the Quran. Now, I don't know whether any of these people have actually studied that description. It is the same description which exists in the Bible and in the Torah and the Talmud. It is the same description. It is a description which is born out of the imagination of somebody who lives in the desert. What is there in heaven? Flowing water, shade-giving trees. And what trees? Just four trees, just four trees. The date, the fig, the olive, and the lemon. They did not know a fifth tree. Now, to place the entire population of those who profess Islam, from Arabia to Afghanistan and then into India, and say that their imagination is determined only by this. If you were to para-drop into Jaisalmer in the month of June and catch the first peasant and say, we are going to build a heaven here, what do you want?
Water.
What will you say?
Water.
Trees, water. What else will you say? The Mughal gardens do not come from this imagination. The Mughal gardens come from the imagination of Babur, who comes from the most fertile valley of Uzbekistan, from Farghana. He built a garden there. He lost the city. He built a garden in Kabul. Both places are hilly, mountainous terrain. There are two spurs and there is a water stream, natural stream passing through. He created terraces, which is what you do in hills if you want to cultivate them. And he planted fruit-bearing trees and all the flowering bushes that he could get. And then he landed up in Agra. Endless desolation, heat, semi-arid. You know what he did? He inverted the slope of the land on that place, dumping lakhs of tons of earth, of clay, and then create terraces. Then he lifted the water of the Jamuna through Persian leaves and let it flow through those terraces. The garden he called the Baagh-e-Gulafshan, which later came to be known as Aram Baagh. And when the Bharatiya Janasangh came to control the Agra Municipal Corporation, they did something that they do very efficiently. They dropped the A and it became Ramba. Go there when next time you are in Agra. There is a plaque outside which lists the plants that Aurangzeb, that Babur planted there. Apricots, plums, pomegranates, apples. None of that survived. But the Mughals are constantly trying to retrieve that garden, till they reach Kashmir and they find the same kind of climate, and then you see what they do there. The next thing they tell you is that the Char Bagh is inspired again by the description of the gardens of Eden. Babur's idea of a garden comes from the Sumerian gardens. And these gardens were divided into four. And there was water flowing through the channels. It is that inspires him. It is this that informs the idea of the Mughal garden. But we are not prepared to look at Babur through any other spectacles than the jaundiced spectacles of Islam. And it is the same about architecture. Yeah.
There were two arches which you show, two arches on which slabs of stone were placed on top of each other. And there was one big slab of stone which was placed on the top of one arch. I understand that in those days there was no binding agent and perhaps cement was also not there. So what did it make the building, the arch to stay in its place? What made it so strong that it did not crumble down under the impact of earthquake or storm or anything like that? Now, you made one statement about which I have my reservations, that all architecture in India is Hindu architecture. But our history books tell us that it is Indo-Muslim architecture, Indo-Islamic architecture which we have inherited during the Mughal rule, and some of our temples have features which are part of Muslim monuments. So there is interaction between Hindu architecture and Islamic architecture.
Sir, I'll begin in the reverse order. My entire argument is against calling architecture in religious terms. I am not saying that there is Hindu architecture. I'm actually saying there cannot be any Hindu architecture. Architecture is not denominational. Just as there cannot be any Islamic architecture. Just as in Europe you have these categories which are either a national or a cultural response. You see, how does architecture come about? You want to build something? What you build depends on four or five very simple things. What do you want to build? What is the material at your disposal? What is the technology that you have to build? And what is the weather or climate in which you are building? It is these four factors that determine the shape of structures that you need. Throughout the Sultanate period, since the Sultanate is not spread all over the country, they are basically concentrated in and around Delhi. They use the locally available stone, which is the Delhi quartz. Delhi quartz is a very hard stone, very brittle, grains are very large, you cannot carve it. You will not see any carving. What you will see is that you build and then you cover it with thick layers of limestone and then you do stucco work on it, incised plaster. But the moment the empire expands and you have sandstone and marble within your reach, softer stones which can be carved, then you see carving begins to happen. And Humayun stone is the first building built exclusively of sandstone and marble, except for the Chabutra, which uses Delhi quartz. There is no Delhi quartz used in the construction. Because this is a monumental structure they are making. They made another monumental structure earlier, several actually. So Qutub Minar, they make an effort to go and get softer stone from 200 kilometers. The mausoleum of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, of Isa Khan, not Isa Khan, of Shamsuddin Altamash, you make the effort. But for day-to-day work, the building you were building were made from Delhi quartz, and that determines the shape, chunky, thick, that you would make. Delicacy comes when you start using softer stone. So my argument essentially is that there is nothing called Islamic or Hindu architecture.
It is only argument.
And when two cultures meet, and this is what I've tried to show, they are borrowing from each other, they are adjusting, they are accommodating, and together they are creating something which is what we know as the syncretic tradition, and you can see it carved in stone.